Bible class, and welcome to our outdoor classroom. I am so honored that you would take a few moments to join me today in the Word of God. And our student participation today was Kingdom Christian Academy. Let's give them a great big round of applause out of Tennessee. And our missionary highlight is Resty and Adriane Riddick from Sierra Leone and Cameroon in Africa. If you've not scored, you know how important that is. Take a few moments. Let's get in God's presence. Maybe you don't have a good playlist. We have a playlist specifically designed by a friend of mine who is a singer-songwriter, Ted Keith Music, and he has it just for our Bible class. The playlist is on all platforms, and you can utilize that from our private Facebook group, Bible Class with Sister Darla. All right, let's look at our faith statement. How many of you love to be around someone that's toxic? Well, first of all, the word toxic is poison, right? And so when you're with someone that is a toxic person, you usually leave feeling pretty discouraged. It just zaps you. Really, it does. But here's the deal. In all of us, there is toxicity, spiritual toxicity. There's negative thinking, negative words, negative actions, and God can release us from this. Spiritual bondage is just things we cannot seem to break free of. Spiritual contamination and malpractice is doing things that would be harmful to ourselves as well as others in the name of Christianity. So this morning, as we speak this out in faith in our prayer time together, I want us to truly speak it and believe that God is going to free us from toxic thinking, from toxic words, from toxic emotions and actions. This is a week of freedom. So we're going to pray together. Lord Jesus, we love you and we thank you for the time that we have together. And Father, we bless the Riddick family and the work that you're doing in Sierra Leone and Cameroon, Lord. And we just pray, God, that you would continue to grow the church, bless the missionaries there, those that are helping the Riddick family. I pray, God, that you would protect and guide and lead them to greater revival, Lord. Even right now, Lord, we release every toxic thought, every toxic word, every toxic emotion, and every toxic action in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we speak freedom from spiritual bondages, spiritual malpractice, and spiritual contamination in Jesus' name. And we ask that a flood of your presence would flow through our homes and our schools today. Every classroom, every student, every parent and teacher. In the precious name of Jesus, illuminate your word in our hearts today. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Woo, I love that. All right, so here's where we're at. First of all, we need to talk about something really important. Our title is the Apostolic CommUNITY. And if you'll notice, the last few letters of that word spells out the word unity. That's right. So let's talk about CommUNITY. Why is this important?
CommUNITY. CommUNITY.
Today, we are seeing the embryonic stage of the apostolic CommUNITY. Now, embryo means nucleus or the very beginning of something. Think itty bitty baby stage. It's one of the earliest stages of development, and here we are with the early church. Peter had just got through preaching a divine message, and the crowd has responded. There's something important to remember about this. This embryonic stage of the church or a new believer is so critical because it can alter the course of destinies if it's not handled well. And here we have a pattern to remember that Luke summed up for us, a pattern of the apostolic community. We can disciple new believers with this pattern, using this pattern. So just like with a cake, you need flour, sugar, eggs, vanilla, milk, butter, all of those things. You can't leave anything out. You really can't, because then it's just not worth eating. I've made too many cakes to know this. The apostolic community seems to have five specific ingredients in it as well. Number one, effective evangelism through preaching. And this is in verse 41. Number two, shared worship and meals. They prayed together. They prayed together and they ate together. How much better can that get, right? Number three, radical commitment to one another. This is where the unity came in. And number four, continued faithfulness. And finally, number five, amazing results. Acts chapter 2, verses 41 through 47 simply says, "Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls." Okay, for all of our mathematicians, I don't know who all had the privilege of baptizing that many people in one day, but if all 120, men and women included, in the upper room baptized 25 people each, the approximation that Luke made of 3,000 in one day is actually doable. I think that's really cool. And we talked about that in our last lesson of empowering believers to carry out the Great Commission. Baptizing is one of those things. Verse 42, "And they continued steadfastly," everybody say it with me, "steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers." I'm not really sure why so many in the world of Christian religions overlook this part. But apostolic doctrine is one of the first areas that Luke highlighted in the community of the church. Now, let's go to fellowship. Fellowship in the Greek is koinonia, and it takes fellowship to the next level. It speaks of a deep sense of sharing an expectation of life together. To the early Christians, a life committed to Jesus Christ was also a life committed to one another. Without fellowship, we become an island left to ourselves. And that's no fun. All right, the next one is breaking of bread. Who doesn't like to have dinner together? Somebody say fried chicken. And finally, prayers. Prayer was the bedrock, the final mark of the church. Not only did prayer usher in Pentecostal passion, it continued to be an important practice throughout the early church. And it's a theme that runs throughout the entire narrative of Acts. Verse 43 says, "And fear," and this word means awe or wonder or great deep respect, "came upon every soul, and many signs and wonders were done by the apostles." Jesus said, "These signs shall follow them that believe." And friends, they still do. It's an amazing result of the apostolic community that follows the divine pattern of the book of Acts. Verse 44 says, "And all that believed were together and had," I love this, "all things common." Can you just say that with me? All things common. Verse 45, "And sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart." The result of learning, sharing, praying, serving, and loving one another was the communal power of, get this, unity. That's right. There was no big I's and little U's, no celebrity. But we're going to notice that idol worshipers tried to make Peter and Paul an object of worship from time to time. But the apostolic community knew who was the real star of the show, and that was Jesus. From leaders to laymen, Jesus had already taught them that that the greatest among you would be the servant of all, in Mark 10:45. He had given them an example, and the unity that flowed from the early church was what spotlighted them to the world. The phrase singleness of heart simply means a sincere and generous heart. Now, isn't that what you feel when you're around a Holy Ghost-filled apostolic man or woman? There's just something about them that it just flows out of them and goes beyond what they're wearing or how they did their hair. It's the power and presence of God, and that's an aura about an apostolic, Holy Ghost-filled individual, and it just glows. And I believe that's what brings favor. And when people sense that you have been with Jesus, they want what you have. Notice what happens. Verse 47 says, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. And I just want to end our lesson by saying this, that if people aren't moved by our witness, we need to go back and align ourselves with this apostolic pattern that the New Testament church had. Students and teachers and parents and whoever our audience is today, I want us to take a simple quiz this morning before we go. And if you have a notebook or a piece of paper, you can follow along with me. And the first one is, am I loving others? In my home, first. In my church, next. And finally, in my community. Because all three of those spheres of influence that God has given us, all three of them matter. Number two, am I serving my family, my church, and my community? Number three, am I learning and allowing God to speak to me through His Word? Number four, am I seeing the favor of God in my relationships at home, at church, and in the community? And finally, am I praying? Each one of these questions are so simple, but they're so important. It's very easy to teach and preach the importance of community or unity among us, but it's entirely different to live it out. It requires the active participation of the Spirit of God, because relationships are not easy. We all have different personalities, and conflicts happen, and we'll read about this throughout the entire narrative of Acts and how they handled it. But we've got to understand one thing. We have an enemy who has a strategy, and he wants to cause conflict in the apostolic community. You can watch this happen throughout history. But if we are a people of the Spirit, the enemy has no strategy that will overpower an apostolic, a true apostolic community that has the five principles or five ingredients in place. God bless. Have a fabulous day.